Thank you everyone for joining us for this webinar on architectural lighting presented by Robert Stonson and Henrik Christensen. My name is Laura Lawrence and I'm the Global Marketing Director at Harman. Just a few things before we get started. Everyone on the call is muted to keep down the noise levels, but you can send in your questions through the chat function and we'll try to answer as many as possible at the end of the presentation. This webinar is also being recorded and the link will be made available a few days after this presentation. We do have a number of other webinars taking place over the next few months for audio, lighting, video, and control, and we'd like to encourage you to take a look at the different webinars in our learning sessions workshop series on pro.harman.com, as well as visiting Harman Professional University to see our many on-demand and certification courses that are available to you for free. And now I'd like to introduce you to my colleagues, Robert Stonson and Henrik Christensen, the presenters for today's webinar. Passionate about creating great lighting products, Robert Stonson joined the Harman Professional Solutions Architectural Lighting Team in 2014. Now, as product manager, Robert is responsible for managing a wide range of products and solutions. As manager of the Design and Application Department at Harman Professional Solutions, Henrik Christensen works with his team to support projects from start to finish, including customized solutions. Since joining Martin in 1997, Henrik has been involved in a large number of international projects. And now I'm going to pass the mic over to you, Robert.
Thank you, Laura, and welcome to this webinar about our architectural lighting portfolio. I'm Robert Stonson, product manager for our architectural range. And today we will go through our product range and we will speak mainly only about our exterior solutions. Hopefully to make it a bit more inspiring, we will take starting point in some of the installations we've done worldwide. So we will take you around the world, starting in Dubai, going to Denmark, going to Atlanta and San Francisco as well, speaking about some of the installations done with our exterior products. Overall speaking, you can say we are offering three different type of solutions with our architectural products. The first one, which we see to the left, is our more traditional, but of course everything is based on dynamic color control and control in general. So we have a number of products to illuminate a building or a facade or a structure. So we have our exterior wash family, we have our exterior linear family, and our exterior in-ground family. And we'll go a bit deeper into these product families, as I said, taking starting point in a specific or a couple of projects. Then we have another solution which can actually be added on top of the wash lighting solutions. That's the possibility to project images in an outdoor environment where we have our exterior projection 500 and 1,000 image or gobo projectors, which we'll also show an example of and talk about these products. And then finally, we have also our direct view solutions. So it means products that you actually mount on the facade or on the building and shining towards the people, creating different type of low resolution media facades. So we have the exterior PIX line, our VC dots, and our exterior dot HP as the building blocks to build up creative ways of doing media facades that integrate well into the architect and the set pieces. So that's a portfolio we're going to spend the next 40 minutes or so talking about, and then we hopefully have some time for questions and answers as well. Well, let's start, and I'll give the word to Henrik from here.
Thank you, Robert. So the first project we're going to speak about is the Birch at a Wrap, and we might see something in the middle of the screen. You need to move, Robert.
Oh, yes, I'll do so.
Thank you. So many of you probably know this iconic landmark in Dubai. Some of you have been there. If not, it's really worth a visit if you're there. But the Burj Al Arab Hotel opened up in 99 after a 5 years construction period. And you can say for Dubai standards, a 20-year-old building is old down there. There's so much going on. But the Jumeirah Group have really been keeping it up to date. They have been renovating and adding over the years. and that also applies to the facade lighting. So the original lighting design was done by Spears and Major, and the overall concept is there's two things to it. One thing is having a really smooth facade lighting covering the entire building. So the main part of the building that you see that is illuminated like a body is around 650 feet tall, a good 200 meters. In top of just being a smooth wash light, they also wanted horizontal bands of lights so they could do like waves, or they could segment the facade into to smaller segments and do different colors. You can say this is a good 20 years ago, and that was probably the first step into media facades where you have a segmented pixel on the facade. The refurb of the lighting was done towards 2016. So the owner wanted to keep the original design, the same lighting positions, and so on for all the products. And the Jumeirah Hotel Group, they wanted a bright fixture, of course, but they also wanted something that could live in a harsh environment as it is in Dubai. The temperature really is extreme down there, and also the humidity is high. On top of that, we are sitting over the ocean with a lot of salt in the air. So really a harsh environment. Then I think we can go to the next slide, Robert. So a part of the work we did to help our distributor, our local distributor and partner in Dubai, was to help out with light calculation to figure out where the light should be positioned. It was quite a task where the positions were already set, because we had to reuse these planter boxes going across the bridge, so we know where the lights were to be positioned, but we still had to figure out how many we needed, what kind of output from each of them, and also what kind of beam spread that was needed. And even that they wanted a lot of light on the building, they also wanted as little glare as possible going into the suites on each side, really to eliminate the guests being blinded. And that's a bit of what you see on this slide, a bit of the positioning. All in total, we have 56 product with a 13 degree lens and 18 with an 11 degree lens. As I said, the lighting part we are illuminating here is around 650 feet, but the angle we are shooting in brings it up to more than 900 feet in total. So you can go to the next slide, Robert. So this is a bit of close-up of how the product are positioned in these planter boxes. In some of the boxes there is greens, as you see, and other ones there is lights. So the ones of you that maybe have been there on the hotel, you can only get in there if you either have a reservation or a dinner reservation, or you can pay, I think it's around $60 or $70 just to get in to see the hotel. So this is not even accessible to the public. On the right side, you see a part of the light distribution, how it comes up to the bottom of the helipad, and that helipad sits in 650 feet of height. But there's also an angle, a curve to the facade, and that means that you can't really reach the top from a close area inside next to the building, and that's why we have to come out from the very far. I think you can go to the next slide, Robert. Yeah. So this is a bit about the family of products that we have used for this application, the exterior wash family. For this application, we have used the 300 and 310, but there's a total you can say 9 products in the range, 3 different sizes and 3 different LED configuration. First one is single color chips, LEDs where you get the really narrow beam and very high intensity, and then you have the exterior wash 110, 210, 310, which is a pre-mixed color, so the color comes mixed out of the product, And then the last one is single color, or not single color, it's single color LEDs, but dynamic white color temperature mix from 2700 to 6500 Kelvin. As I also touched briefly on, that the products are really meant to work in this hard environment. Same goes for cruise line and so on, both with the heat and the salty air. They're really meant to be working in those conditions. I think you can go to the next slide, Robert. A bit on the accessories, some of them are also used at the Bird's LRAP. From the left, you see a standard configuration. Then you see the prismatic lens system we have. You see the various beams options. It goes down from a 7 up to like a 60 degree beam with different steps. There's also asymmetric lenses, as you see on the right color full picture of the beam shaper. But they are very easily installed to the front of the fixture with the lens and the ring. It means that you don't have to open up the fixture for any lens change. And always opening up the fixture, there is a risk for water getting in, so you don't have to do that in this case. We also have a snoot to eliminate glare from the product. That's the third photo, as well as the Honeycomb louver to eliminate glare from the products. You can go to the next slide. On the back side of all the product, there is an display for ease of configuration of the fixture. You can set the TMX addresses and so on. All the products are also RDM ready, so they speak RDM for ease of setting up the products. Next slide. This is actually Robert and I on top of the birch. It's an older photo. I can definitely see I have gained some weight since that. So the products we're looking at there is our exterior 400 range. I think this was back in 13 or 14. The very top of Birch LRAP was refurbed with those LED products, and then later on the front we just looked at. But we actually have a long tradition with the Jumeirah Hotel Group, the neighbor hotel, the wave you see to the right here, the Jumeirah Beach Resort, is also lit up by Martin products, and we also have products inside the Bird's LRAP. If some of you have been in the industry for a long time, you might remember our old Mac 500. They were part of the interior lighting design from the opening of the hotel. And that brings me over to the next project that Robert is going to speak about. So over to you, Robert.
Thank you, Henrik. Okay, so that was a little bit about our wash light solutions. I will continue with exterior projection. So what we're looking at here is a beautiful historical greenhouse in San Francisco. And obviously most of the stuff there was going on at daytime. So they wanted to have something that would make customer visits more interesting and appealing at nighttime as well. And they had this facade that they wanted to illuminate. It was not a permanent installation as such, but it actually was extended. So it has been running at least for 6 months. So they did not have a budget for a full-blown video projection with everything collapsing and crazy stuff. That was way beyond their budget. So they were looking into something more realistic and also more maintenance free and also less running costs. So that's where we came into the picture with the exterior projection. And this company, Obscura Digital, they were very, very advanced and had done a lot of digital video projection projects, but this was the first time where they had to use, let's say, classical gobo projection, analog projection, but still creating something fascinating and time-coded. So the beauty of it was that they used the entire building as one canvas, and they achieved to use, they had 10 pieces of our exterior projection 500, and they mapped these images together so they became one big complete image. And then of course they could change, they had a number of variables. They could, of course, change the gobo. The 500 has 6 gobos, so they could change and show different images, and the images is actually some of the flowers found in the botanical garden that they photographed and made into a gobo. At the same time, they also used the wash lights, so that gives a nice depth in the picture. So you see the blue and purple color is actually coming from a wash, from wash lights, and then on top you have the image projection with the 500. So again, when you work with projection, you need to do a lot of preparation and at least some considerations. Specifically where to place the fixtures. In this case it was, I don't know if it was fully given, but they had these two sheds where they were able to hide the products just under the ceilings of these two sheds. And so it meant that some of the angles were very direct onto the building and some had an angle and would also create some distortion to the image. So what they did, since they came from this digital video projection background, they actually went, let's say, the full-blown way. They mapped the building, laser scanned the building, created a 3D model, and using these projection mapping techniques in order to create the gobo. So on the left, we see one of the gobos that were designed for this building, and you can actually recognize some of the distortion that is in the gobo design itself. So it means when we project this image towards the building from that specific angle, it will map the building correctly and look natural on the building. So it takes into account that distortion that will happen from that angle of where the product is placed. So this is let's say an advanced but very good way of creating a very nice, beautiful design where the gobos are mapped together. But I would say less can also do. The fixtures comes with standard set of gobos, but I would say in most cases we see people are designing custom gobos because there's a certain message, a certain idea behind the reason why they choose to work with image projection. Of course, it can be as simple as just, but still very effective, showing the company logo. But actually, we see most of the installations we see is actually where people want to work with these abstract patterns and create something extraordinary with the building. So a more cost-efficient way of creating gobos is to use a grid gobo. So that's what we see in the top left corner. So it's simply a gobo with a very precise grid pattern with some numbers and some letters, and then you would find the position where you want to place the product, where you want to install the product. You place the product in exact that position with exact that angle you intend for the final installation, and you insert this gobo into the fixture and project onto the building. So that's what we see on the lower left. In this case, they did it at daytime, so but we still recognize the image. They also used a different grid gobo than the one we have in the accessory, but the idea is the same. So then you take an image from the position of the fixture, as this image is, and then you can easily understand now where will the light hit the building, where will it be blocked, what is not hitting the building, what is just being considered as false light or unintended light. And then from this information you can now import this image into a graphical program like Adobe InDesign or Adobe Photoshop or any other graphical program, and then you work with another layer and start mapping your image to the building, because you know exactly where the light will hit the building. You can look at the pattern, the grid structure, you can look at the numbers and the letters supporting the grid structure, and then from that you design the gobo. And that's what you see here. In this case it's Roscoe, one of the gobo manufacturers. There are several gobo manufacturers around the world. We don't do gobos. We deliver the products with a standard set of gobos, but if you want a custom gobo, you have to go to one of these expert companies that know everything about distortion and multi-layer, multi-color gobos, as this one we see here. And so this is what they're good at. We are good at making fixtures. So in this case, we see it's quite an advanced gobo design that really maps very tightly into the building. You see the window frames. You even see how the lighting is mapped towards the small trees in front of the building. And on the right side, we see the end result. So this was done at a demo day, a demonstration day at our distributor in Switzerland, Menzi, that wanted to demonstrate the capabilities and the possibilities of using gobo projection. So basically, we have two sizes. They more or less do the same. The exterior projection 1000 is 3 times as bright as the 500. It also has a full zoom system. It has full color mixing, where the smaller one has a fixed beam angle, and it works with fixed colors. But they both do crisp gobo image projection. So it comes, in this case, with the 500, with the 6 standard gobos. There's a service lid on top of the product, so it's fairly easy to change the gobos. It's not something you do every day, but it is possible to change the gobos, and there's a special procedure how to secure that the product has been sealed correctly and that no humidity has been trapped inside the product. Comes with 6,500 lumen and 4 different beam angles. And then, of course, not only you have the gobos, the images, but you can work with the focus. A lot of effects can happen just from focusing and defocusing a gobo. You can work with, there are prisms inside of the product. We have an animation effect, which will make the gobo twinkle a little bit or wave as a flag in the wind. And then there's also a frost effect. As I said, the 1000, around 3 times as much output. It has a fully a zoom system, so you can adjust the beam angle remotely, and it has full color mixing as well. It also has a bit more advanced animation effect system than the little brother. So that's really the creative tools, and still it's something that is, I would say, very much appreciated by the lighting designers. It gives them a new tool in a safe manner, because this product is designed for a permanent install. Okay, so that was a little bit about our exterior projection range, and then I'll give the word to Henrik to talk about another of our products.
Thank you. So now we are in Herning in Denmark. We went from sunny California and Dubai to a bit colder area. This one is the Jyske Bankboksen, which is, you can say, a multi-purpose arena in Denmark. It has a capacity of 12,500 people. So for Danish size, it's a rather large indoor arena, and it's also where big concerts like Metallica, Lady Gaga, Springsteen and so on have been taking place. The arena itself opened in 2010. And then more recently in 18, this foyer area, the big box in front of it, was added. And the owners and operator of the arena found that there was a need to have more room for restaurant, bars and other hospitality areas when they had concerts and other events in the arena. And the first event it opened for in 18 was the World Championship in ice hockey that took place in Denmark. Both the architect and owner wanted the new foyer area to have a dynamic lighting solution. They had that vision from the very beginning. And as you can see it, the facade is made out of inflatable triangles. So it's like a 5-layer system with air, with compressed air in between. And that also works as the insulation on the building. So you can go to the next photo there. Yep. So this one shows a bit of the visual appearance of the building. So the product used here is the exterior linear in a quad color version. We'll come back to what that means. There's 268 of these triangles with one product in each. So this also works as a very low resolution media facade, and we'll come back to speaking a bit about that as well. You can jump to the next slide. So here we see how the product is integrated, and you also see a bit of the inflatable facade. You even see the air tubes that going into it and keeping it air pressured all the time. For this application, they needed a custom paint white, including our louver in front to eliminate the glare, to be painted in custom color, and so we did for this project. You can go to the next slide. So, as you might know, there's a maximum of 32 products per DMX link. These exterior linear product is run by DMX, so there's some DMX splitter used. And for this application, there is a media player called MAP from a Danish company called Collision. And the MAP player is basically the media server that provide the content for the facade. If it's national colors like used for the World Championship in ice hockey, or if it's corporate colors, or if it's other animated things moving around the facade, it's done with that media, server or that content player called MAP. So you can go to the next one. Here we see a few more photos of the building itself, both on the inside and outside. But it really gives them some flexibility and some possibility to create different patterns, both static patterns or slowly moving color changes. One of the reasons why our product was chosen for this, the exterior linear quad, was that it's out of the output, it's really bright. You need a good amount of light also to deal with the normal interior lighting that is used for the restaurants and so on inside. And the other reason is that there is it is pre-mixed light coming out of it, so it's a quad LED chip, red, green, blue, and white in one chip, meaning that the color shattering you will see in the five layers of fabric doesn't exist the same way as would if you had like single color LEDs with individual colors. So you can go to the next slide. So the exterior linear have the same concept as the exterior was, and we try to have that same red line going through all our products that they come in the quad chip, as you see in the middle, so red, green, blue, white in one LED, or single LEDs, as you see to the left. The benefit with the single LEDs is that you get a little more light than you have from the quad, but again, it depends on the application. If you want to eliminate the color shattering, then the quad is really the way to go. And we also have the color temperature mixing unit to the far right. So these products all have built-in power supplies. There's no additional boxes needed to get them running. It's just a matter of applying data and power, and it's a hybrid cable. So we combine power and data in one cable, and your cable to run up to 100 feet from one power supply. If we go to the next slide, this one shows a bit about the different accessories we have available. We have the anti-glare in a few different versions, the one you saw in the previous photo and the one in the drawing here, which is just a single side barn door. They come with adjustable brackets, so for easily focusing towards the image. There's various cable lengths, both to interconnect them and also as feed in and feed out. And same as the wash range, they are IP66 and really meant to be used for outdoor uses in harsh environment. Both for this product and for the rest of the exterior product, they dim themselves. If they should go into an application where it gets too warm, then they will dim the output so you don't harm the fixtures. Yes, that was it. Then over to you again, Robert.
Thank you, Henrik. Okay, so from Denmark, we jump to Atlanta. And So we've been talking about wash lights, we've been talking about projection, talk about linears. So what we're going to talk about now is direct view solutions or media facades. In this case, it was an existing building. It's called American College Football Hall of Fame. And they had this existing facade with these frosted glasses, and they had a high resolution digital signage here. But they had this huge facade that was not really illuminated at night time, and they wanted to create something special about that. And the good thing was that there was access to the behind of these glass panels, so we were able to, the integrator was able to install a media facade solution behind the glasses, the glass panels. And the product used for this one is the VC.9, which is our string-based dot solution. And in total, there were more than 17,000 dots on this huge facade. So if we just jump to a nighttime picture here, we actually, first of all, what we could recognize here is that the content that was designed for this facade was custom made for this particular installation. So you see, in this case, it's a content that highlight each of these glass panels in different colors. We cannot show videos here in the WebEx meeting, but we have a very nice video really showing, and that's really what typically our dynamic solutions deserves, that you see the video to understand. One thing is to see a snapshot of a content, but of course something more magical happens when you see the content running in real time. So what is interesting here is that we actually have a super, super low resolution. We have 6 inches between each pixel pitch, so 15 centimeter. And there's this thumb of rule that comes from video screens. It doesn't necessarily apply for media facades as such, but where you say you need to have, in centimeters, you need to be 10 times away to understand, so you don't see the pixels anymore. But so it would mean that we would have to be around 500 feet or 150 meter away from this building if we didn't want to see the pixels. But realistically, you would normally be standing around 40 to 50 meters away from the building maximum if you stand on the other side of the street. But still, it looks absolutely amazing. And you can even, as you see on the upper left picture, you can understand and you can read a text, and it doesn't look super dotted. And there are many reasons for that. It actually also helps if it's a dynamic content. Now it's just a snapshot again. But first of all, these dots are placed behind this frosted material in a distance of around one inch from the frosted glass. So it means that it bleeds up the dot itself, so you don't see that direct glary spot from the dot. And secondly, it's the way our human brain works is that it's actually able to fill out the missing information, part of information, and filling out the blanks. So we immediately understand it says the University of Georgia as an example. So that means that thumb of rule that goes for video screens doesn't necessarily apply for traditional media facade. So this is what we see on this slide here is the total dot layout. It's quite a big facade. It's 47 meter in the length of 156 feet and around 26 feet high or 8 meter high. So it's a huge facade. But if you look at the resolution, these 17,000 pixels, it's actually super low. It's actually 48 by 312 pixels. So if we compare with the monitor we're all probably looking at it right now, it's probably 920 by 1080. And this one is then magnified to a much, much bigger size. So it is actually quite interesting to understand how much is possible even with such a low resolution. But it also means that if we just ran, of course we could run a football match and run it on this super low resolution, but it would probably look pretty bad and it would be very hard to understand what content was running. So it's also a matter of designing content that fits that facade and fits the intention and the design behind it. So in this case, it was very obvious that we had these big glass panels and you could play around these glass panels. And also on top of that, there's a print in the glass, which we'll see on a couple of slides. So what we believe is very strong about our video solutions, because it, of course, it gets more complex than traditional lighting solutions. It is more complex for sure, but we still believe we've reduced the complexity quite a lot. We don't have an enormous lot of system components and setup and what have you to get the system up running. So typically, if we start from the top, you will have a media server. We don't sell media servers, so it could be any media server. In fact, it could just be a PC running a YouTube video, but in most cases, you would use a professional media server. Then you have the P3 system controller. This is the kind of the brain behind the whole system. This is the part that maps the right pixels or the right content to the fixtures. And the beauty about the P3 system is that it's very easy to map the fixtures according to how they are placed physically on the building. So the user interface is very easy to use. It's very easy to drag and drop the fixtures. It's very easy to rotate them, angle them, and then understand how the content will overlay on the products and which pixels basically will be played on the different products. And you can even use different type of products. In this case, it was only the VC.9, but even if it had been a combination of VC dot, 16 pixel line, the P3 system will automatically take that into account and set the right content to the different type of fixtures. Then the third box we have is basically a power supply. It's called the P3 power port, and it provides the power, a 48 volt power supply to the fixtures, and at the same time send the data to the fixtures. Then we have a small converter box that converts into 15 volts, and then we have the string itself. And the string is to keep the cost down. It's this product is based on that the dots are sitting on a string. But the smart thing is that we customize the strings, so you can get the pixel pitch you want, and you can get the lead-in cable you want, and you can even have different pixel pitch on the same string. So in this case, we had on each of these big glass panels, we had 7 strings of VC dots, and then we had a power port glass panel. And here we see a few pictures from behind the facade, where we see all the many dots sitting in these aluminium rails. We have the VC feeder, and then we have the IP rated power ports sitting on the real wall behind here. So in this case, it was very easy to install, and also it's very easy to maintain the installation. And here we see a few exams. Again, video would be nice, but on the upper left and the lower right, you actually see that the persons there, that's actually printed into the glass itself. So in the upper left, the content becomes dark, and in the lower right, the content becomes white. So that's two examples of pixel accurate content. And the upper right is actually, I just took it from Google today. It's a recognition of the workers that, the volunteers that works with the COVID-19 virus in Atlanta. So they wanted to recognize this association, apparently called Light Bit Blue. So they can be very agile in the content creation as well. So we have the VC dot we have in three different sizes. So it's really only a matter of output intensity, brightness. How much brightness do you need? In this one, it was quite a huge installation. It had to be installed behind the frosted glass, so that's why the VC.9 was chosen. But in many cases, the VC.1 will be sufficient for direct view applications. Again, because of power consumption, we have some different limitations. You can have 100 dots on for VC.1, 64 for VC.4, and 36 for the VC.9. And then you can have, you simply specify which dot spacing you want and which leading cable you want, and you can even have different dot spacing on the same string. So that was American Football Hall of Fame in Atlanta, and then I'll go over to you, Henrik.
Thank you. So in all of these projects we just looked at, or actually in three of them, the one from California with projection, we didn't have any customization, but the rest of them had some kind of element of customization into the product. And for the ones of you that work with architectural lighting and so on, so now we have that block boxing. Thank you, Robert. For the ones of you that work with architectural lighting, you know there is a need to customize products from project to project, and we also support that. That's actually done from my team. Just a few examples. It could be light engines. We spoke about that we have single color LEDs and so on, but there is also requirements to make products that might only be half red, half blue. That's the two colors they're going to use, or mix in between. So we can make the circuit boards with that kind of LED placement. We also do a lot of housing colors in different customization to fit into a public area where they go into some kind of structure where they need to fit in. It could be also be longer cables on product if they're going in up in poles where you need some additional distance on the cables. We can do that. For larger supplies of projects, we can also do custom colors and gobos. For smaller projects, it's done through our distributors network globally. Then we look at the exterior pitch line, the third last picture, and that product is done into various lengths. And as Robert said from the last presentation from Atlanta here, the VC dot strings, we do them in customization, both in the pixel pitch, the distance in between LEDs, but also on how many pixels you want on a string. The three examples underneath here is, the first one is the Harbour Bridge in Auckland, and there's three kind of products on that one. There is exterior wall slides, but there's also the VC.9 and exterior PixLine creative video products, and both the exterior PixLine and the VC dot is done in a custom length to fit to the needs of the application. The picture in the middle is from the AIDA cruises, where there is a huge indoor pool area that at night time converts into a nightclub. And they have a big a big cover that's actually also an inflatable cover that is on there, and that is illuminated with the PixLine. And the customization here was different bracketing, so it fitted into the bespoke purpose on this cruise line. And the last photo to the right is from Copenhagen here in Denmark, from the Tivoli Garden theme park, where there was a need to change the orientation of the LEDs to make the cable routing easy. So basically every second fixture had a mirrored LED orientation, so they were sitting there the same way. So just a few examples on what can be done in regards to customization, and we are happy to support that. So over to you, Robert.
Yes. So I just want to spend a few words on what about quality. And of course, when we talk about outdoor products, the first thing people normally will recognize or talk about is the IP rating, and all our exterior products are IP66 rated. But it's important to understand that the story doesn't end there. Of course, it's important that the product is water and dust tight. That's a very good first step for having a safe installation, permanent installation. But there's so much more that can go wrong. So we have chosen for all our products that they are all marine graded. So it means they are they have a very good corrosion rating and are able to withstand the environment, even at coastal areas or even at cruise ships, bridges. So that is standard on our products that they have this additional coating that complies with this ISO standard. And then also it's important, since it's outside, you can have bad weather, you can have weather storms, you can have lightning. And even if the lightning strikes very far away from your installation, you will see these peaks on the electrical network. And so it is important that fixtures, any outdoor fixtures, are protected. And of course, if you're a street light company, there's nothing new to this. But if you come from different industries, this might be new. So all our products are protected up to 4 kilovolts. And that's not only on the power, it's also on the DMX input. So we have the same protection there, because you don't know where the lighting will strike. And of course, there's also other considerations. So one could be vandalism rating. So I would say most of our products are IK8, meaning it's another standard that where you basically take a metal ball and drop on the product and see if it breaks. And if it doesn't, there are different standards depending on the height and the weight of that metal ball. And of course, there's a lot of other environmental tests that we are doing. And what we have learned is that it can be difficult to communicate. So we have created this document that we call Product Verification and Reliability Report that lists all the different environmental standards that our products undergo, and also tells about which standards we test up against, and what is the duration of the test, and what is the test result, and which laboratory has been doing the testing. And this is a document that is available for all our exterior products on the respective product pages on our web page. And also, finally, just want to mention that, of course, we have, and we know that's required, we have specification sheets that includes all details about products. We really, actually, within the last year or so, we have updated all our specification sheets. So they really are enriched with a lot more information, also about which gobos, which colors, some more photometric information. Of course, we also have the IES files available for download if you want to work in photometric programs. And we also have AutoCAD drawings as well, but our specification sheets gives you everything in one document, so you should be able to specify the product and finding all the required information in the specification sheet. So that was our presentation. So we succeeded in having 10 minutes time for questions and answers, or at least questions. Let's see if we can find some answers to those questions. So let's hope we have some good questions out there.
Yep, we did have a few come in. The first question is asking if you can tell them the color temperature that they get in the RGBW version when all LEDs are on.
Yes, we can. It's probably not the most interesting, because basically you can. Most of our products have the white color in most of our products are 6,500 Kelvin, and then you can basically adjust by using the RGB to nearly say any color temperature, from very low down to 2,000 Kelvin and maybe up to 10,000 Kelvin. When you put everything at full, it's often I would say a bit strange, not necessarily a desirable color temperature.
The next question, in the exterior projection, how do we minimize the spillage of the gobo projections onto nearby buildings, if any?
Good question. So it's really back to be careful in the design of the gobos, and that's why we recommend to use this grid structure gobo, where you understand where will the light hit the building, and then you design gobos that really cut away, that really maps the light to the building. To be fair, the disadvantage is then that you will not be able to use the rotation functionality, because then if you start rotating the gobo, then it will not map to the building anymore. But the best is to design gobos that fits or maps exactly to the building.
Okay, the next question. On exterior linear lights, can the hybrid cables 10-5-1 meter be shortened or lengthened if used indoors in a very tight space that cannot accommodate excess cabling between fixtures?
That maybe I should answer that one, Robert. But that's probably where we can look into either a custom solution and so on. But it is what that goes in between the two product is standard power and standard data cable. So yes, other cables can be used, but they need to be in the end terminated into our connector. But if there's any questions there, you can get the contact details, Laura, and then we can work more in details on that.
But maybe also worth to mention is that you can actually do an end-to-end connection of the exterior linears. You don't need to have an internet connecting cable. They connect directly to each other as well.
Okay, next question. What is the software we use to control the system?
You want to take that, Henrik?
Sure. So in for the main part of the products, for all the typical lighting product, the wash lights, the linear, the projection, it's a DMX control, and that's a common standard, international standard, and there's many producers out there of software or consoles that can control these products. So we work with a few close, like the Faro systems, but it's a standard protocol. And then for the more video-based applications, like you saw with the project in Atlanta, it's video content, it's a DVI signal like you have from your laptop to your external monitor, for instance. So that can be any video source. Usually, it's some kind of media server or the video player that we showed for the boxing project from Collision. So there's also a wide range of suppliers for that. But I think that what we can recommend there is to get with either our local team, if you're based in the US or with our distributor throughout the world, and they can support you on that as well, or also welcome to contact us directly.
Okay, the next question is asking, what is the main difference between Cree LED and Osram LED, and why?
Well, both of them are two very well-respected, huge LED manufacturers. So it's we test different LEDs and choose the one that suits that specific product the best. So probably it was. Question is probably related back to the slide for the exterior linear, where we use the Osram for the quad color and we have the Cree for the single color solution. And in that case, well, the Osram LED was the best choice for the lens in front of the quad color LED. But it's not like we are in favor of one particular company. What we are in favor of is using quality vendors of LEDs. Of course, there are also smaller companies doing them. Maybe they're good, but often they are not able to secure a long-term deliverable of the same LED, and also to secure that you get the right bins, meaning that you get the same narrow color range that we request for our products. But it's not like we are using Cree, Osram, and other LED manufacturers.
All right, the next question is asking, do we have software from where we can predict results and needs regarding amount of product?
Yes, so there is software out there common available in the market. In the US, something called AG32 is used a lot. Also, maybe more in Europe, Dialox is used. And we as a manufacturer provide something called IES files that can be downloaded free from our web page and used in these light calculation programs to figure out how much, how many products there's needed, what kind of beam spread you want to use. And that was actually what we did for the Birch LRAP project. We did a Dialox calculation to figure out at what distance, how much light would we had, and how wide would the beam be. And that way around, you figure out how many products there's needed. But there's a few different suppliers. So again, one is the AG32, and one other one is Dialox. And there's other makers of this kind of software as well.
All right, the next question is asking if there are any quantity minimums for customization.
In general, we have a 10 unit minimum quantity for the products. Some of the exterior projection, the number is less, but in general, it's 10 products. Of course, it also depends a bit on what the customization is. Now what we have showed so far is like variants of what we do. Something that is it doesn't take a lot of engineering. If it's something that is more or deeper customization that we've been speaking about, then the number could be higher. But I think it's always worth seeing if we can come up with a solution. So yeah, reach out to either local sales in US or distributor, and then we can assist that way around.
All right, the next question is asking, what exterior linear designs typically choose to use RGBW over quad and vice versa?
So, I'll say probably if we look into our sales numbers as well, it's the quad version of the wash light and the linear is probably the one with the highest sales, because that one is the one that is easiest to integrate and you don't have any color shattering. But there might be some application where you really need that extra output or a bit more narrow beam that you can get from the physics of the quad LED, and that's when you will go with the narrow, more narrow and single color LEDs. It's a bit hard to speak about the application, but you can say longer throw. Yeah, then you maybe go with the single color LEDs because you have the distance to have the colors to mix. And then for short throw, you go with the quad. But yeah, it's all about the application.
And maybe to add on that also, as we saw in the example with the arena, that if there's a risk, if you could say that the audience can actually see the product themselves and look into the product itself, then of course it will be in favor of using a pre-mixed quad color solution, because it simply looks more elegant, more nice when seeing these individual colors, color LEDs.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, and the next question is asking what kind of light engine the Exterior Projection 1000 uses.
Actually, we, I'll say for all our products, we have decided to inform the manufacturer of the LED, so it's part of the specification sheet. So on the 1000, it's an Abitronix light engine.
Okay. Can we do projection mapping with Exterior 1000 or Exterior 500 fixtures?
Yes, but it's analog projection mapping. It's not digital projection mapping. So it means that you still only have 6 or 7 gobos, as we find in the 1000, and you can map those images, the gobos, together, as we saw on the project in San Francisco, to create one entire image. Out of, in that case, 10 fixtures. But of course, it will not be like looking at a movie, because we are not selling video projection. And then maybe the next question would be, why do you not sell video projection? Why don't you do Panasonic? Why don't you do like Panasonic or Barco, which are fantastic solutions? I think we all enjoyed one of these installations. But it's more, at least in our opinion, more a temporary solution that you use for maybe a day or a week or something festive, because the cost and also the running costs are extremely high compared to analog image projection as we do. So we kind of say this is a more budget friendly but still very interesting solution for doing image projection.
Okay, the next question is asking, how do you calculate the distance from the building to the installation position of the light of the Burj Al Arab building?
So that comes back to the lighting calculation tools, to either Dialogs or AutoCAD or whatever program people are working in. But in this case, it was the Dialogs that was used for that.
But you will also on our specification sheets, we often have a table that shows some different distances, maybe 5, 10, 15, 20 meter, and then the corresponding beam angle and sensor intensity. So that can give you a quick way of understanding which beam angle to use and which where to place the product.
Yeah, there's even a formula there that if you put the distance from the setback you have, then it will, with that formula, it will tell you how wide the beam will be at the surface you're shooting at.
Okay, it looks like that was the last question that came in, and I think we're at time. So Robert and Henrik, thank you so much for doing this presentation, and everyone who attended, thank you for taking your time to spend with us on this webinar. If you're interested in any of our upcoming sessions, there's a full calendar on pro.harman.com, and all of the webinars are recorded and posted out to our YouTube channel. Thanks, everyone, and have a great day.